humble part, I'm going to create a culinary YouTube website, and I'm going to teach kids how to cook really amazing, good food, and then we're going to, you know, so that the rehab building becomes a stage set for a culinary experience. And the kids are super excited to do well because they're going to be on TV, and they know they're going to be YouTube clips.
Let me intervene just for a second and make a little bit of an abstract theory point to join it with this. A lot of the sociologists in their other courses have heard what really matters is race, class, gender, and national origin, if you're Polish or Jewish or whatever. Theaster has not mentioned any of those. And what I've been showing for in research for 20 years, whatever, is those explain about 15%. He's adding other things. He's talking about people interested in theater, people who are interested in this. That is, he's bringing in aesthetics to define social groups. Sociologists ought to think this way, and we have the tools to do so if we talk about things like issue specificity, roles and different statuses, and consumption statuses and activities, as well as production. So you didn't say the people are, you know, a banker came to me.
Right.
You're saying someone interested in the theater, and
yeah.
So it's that same person. Maybe he's a banker, but because he loves the theater and he did something which you did with theater, that makes a different kind of relationship, and you have a different set of concerns which link here. And it involves an aesthetic sensitivity to, in this example, theater.
So I'm just making this big point
because most sociologists never hear this, but it's part of the magic which he's doing instinctively, which is not old style race, class, gender, and national origin.
One example is just when Cabrini-Green was doing its redevelopment, and they were converting. I remember being in a pre-professional science program in Iowa, and this program was trying to attract more women into the sciences. And so instead of just offering a scholarship at the college level, they were starting to target eighth grade girls. And that there was this kind of understanding that in order to get the outcome that they wanted, there had to be an investment way in advance in the lives of the people they were trying to get to. So there were these tracks of programs made in middle schools to capture these eighth grade girls who were maybe not interested in science, give them mentors, let them know that in the future there would be these scholarships, and then these tracks were made. And Iowa State did amazingly well at then getting women in ag business and ag engineering and so on and so on. And I mention that because in some ways, I understand that a record store for money, or a library in its formal sense, or certain kinds of businesses, maybe if they were to move to my neighborhood, they would fail if they were to try to live as a business proper, right? And so rather than try to create a business proper, I understood that there might need to be an intermediary step where we engage a community to just kind of create an environment where a record store might flourish in the future. So by starting with a listening house where nothing's for sale, but there's great music there and there are people who can start to program it, by starting with Black Cinema House where there's free film that could happen, we can tease out who the film lovers are, we can start to create networks of local film goers, so that we're not just pulling from all over other parts of the city, but we can get folk who are there, that we were kind of doing the preliminary research and development, but also track making, right, for girls in the sciences. That there was a way in which a pre-investment was necessary in order to make cultural vitality possible and sustainable in the future. So when people talk to me about whether or not a thing is sustainable, it's like, no, it's not sustainable. If Starbucks won't come here, if Nike won't come, it's not sustainable in that traditional model. But what are the things necessary in advance of its sustainability in order to generate sustainability? And so I think that in some ways, we were piloting and demonstrating culture in advance of offering a new economic district on 69th and Stony Island. Like, if that were to happen today, Stony Island might not be ready for it. But are there ways that we can translate the need for culture into the willingness to spend money on culture, right? So would Reckless Records be willing to have a listening shop in advance of building a for-profit Reckless Records in a neighborhood? And maybe in poor neighborhoods, that could be a strategy where you introduce the cultural piece in advance of introducing the monetized moment.
We had a sociology PhD student 2 years ago do a paper on Reckless Records just for the...
Oh, right on. The archive or the cultural offering actually doesn't always matter that much. The part that matters more is the interface between the cultural offering and how that thing communicates to a public or to multiple publics. So with the University of Chicago's Glass Lantern slides, I don't know how interested a 15-year-old is going to be immediately in medieval Renaissance painting. But there are ways in which, with the right curator, programmer, creative, that you could talk about Renaissance painting in new ways, right? Or you could demonstrate a forum for talking about art history in a very different forum than an art historian would. And so that interface work becomes very important. I think it was like, well, yeah, the records came up, the slides came available, the books came available, all of them random projects. How do we make it as beautiful as possible in the context of this neighborhood? And then how do we try to think as ambitiously as possible about the interface so that people would at least be curious? In most cases, the stuff became a backdrop for other kinds of fun that really, people weren't really interested, but it made the house really sexy, right? And so what we found was really food was the thing that worked very well, and that the conversations over food was like, so where'd you get those again? That's weird. And then people might browse, but it gave people a reason to hang longer, mm-hmm. right? And so hang time became really important to me. Like, how do we get people to just want to be on 69th and Dorchester longer than they would be? And so I asked those questions also. How do we get people to hang on Garfield Boulevard where the incubator is? So when it was just an incubator and the only public offering we had was the exhibition space, people would come see the exhibition, they'd leave. But once we had a cafe, it's like they'd come to the cafe, they'd go see the exhibition, they'd go back to the cafe. And I think that in the art world, we talk about, you know, artists and curators think a lot about, like, how long can a painting hold you? Is it something that you look at while you're walking by, or does it stop you for like 3 minutes, right? 7 minutes. Stay. How long will you look at an experimental video or an audio piece? And so you think about those things as a kind of psychology of listening, but there's a lot loaded in that question of how long will you hang? And I think that thinking about that is also like maybe why the Soho House is really popular, like in a way, or why McDonald's started adding McKids World, you know, because it's like the longer you hang, for the capitalist, the more money you might spend. But it's like, the longer you hang, the more we might develop a network, the more likely you might talk to other people. And so there could be these other exchanges that happen. They're asking about me, but I think that actually, if we could replace me, if we could pull the Theaster part out, and kind of think about how cultural transformation happens and how gentrification happens and how the creation of cultural districts happen in a city, that there are lots of different ways that culture lands in a place And we could identify those ways and lots, you know, we could say, okay, the city of Phoenix is going to invest $50 million into an under-invested neighborhood. And as a result, they're going to try to create some new energy over there. And that $50 million, like we saw in Akron, Ohio, money could be invested, but if the wrong group of people are not engaged, if a certain kind of process didn't happen, then that money is really only part of what could help to create a place, and it still ends up flat. And so I think that while this is about the phenomenon of our process in Chicago, I want us thinking about our own hometowns, our own neighborhoods, and thinking about the things that have worked and not worked, because we'll find that usually there is, in addition to governmental involvement, there are individuals who really believe in a place, and they're either with the parent teacher association, or they start up a local chamber of commerce. That there are people that are using different kinds of tools, and so it's really just a matter of, given the tools that you have access to in a particular place, how do you make the most? How do you leverage those resources in the best way? So even though it's the Theaster show, I'm imagining that we're trying to say to Gary, in the absence of Theaster, you got some good things going on. How do we leverage those assets so it doesn't feel so specific, site-specific, person-specific? Because then foundations and the government says, well, what if Theaster gets hit by a car? It's like, I'm not the point. The point is culture should thrive and grow, and that there are lots of different ways to happen. What are some of the specific articulated ways that could happen? And in this case, it happened to have been artist-led.